So we now have a closed system of four hydrodynamic equations. We have the Navier-Stokes equation, we have the Poisson and the continuity equation, and we have the equation of state. So this system is a closed system and can be solved, but if we want to apply this to the interstellar medium, we find that the equation of state is a bad description of the real equation of state of the interstellar medium, and that's because the polytropic equation of state is a strong oversimplification of our true interstellar medium. And this is for a variety of reasons. So first of all, the assumption of an adiabatic process is not holding in the interstellar medium. We have energy exchange with the environment. So as a result, the inner energy may change because we have friction with the neighborhood, so the motion of other fluid elements. We can introduce additional energy into our system. We might have electric heat dissipation when we have currents, so when we have charged particles moving through a magnetic field. This might introduce additional heat dissipation. We might have radiation entering our fluid volume element and introduce additional energy because the radiation is absorbed. And we might have chemical reactions taking place that either absorb or take up energy, or because they are endo-energetic, or they might be exo-energetic chemical reactions, so they release energy to the interstellar medium. So we have to replace our very simple equation of state with a more general equation of state that describes the internal energy of the volume E as a function of the density and the temperature. So again, here the non-capital E is the inner energy density, so that's the inner energy normalized to a given volume. So the name for this equation is the caloric equation of state. This is a very general term, and it can in principle include many different effects that may affect the internal energy of the gas. So here we are looking primarily on the fluid as ideal gas. So we can write down the internal energy density is the heat capacity at constant volume times T, and that can be written as a function of the internal degrees of freedom NF, half times KB divided by the molecular mass times the temperature. So KB is the Boltzmann constant. We have the molecular mass of a gas particle. Then NF is the number of internal degrees of freedom per gas particle. And the internal degrees of freedom depend on the type of gas. So when you have a monoatomic gas, so a single particle, then we have 3 degrees of freedom for translation, so we can move in 2 different directions, so in the plane of the screen here, and we might have an out-of-plane degree movement. So we have 3 coordinates that describe our motion. For a 2-atomic gas, like molecular hydrogen, for example, or carbon monoxide, we have again these 3 degrees of freedom for translation, and we have two additional degrees of freedom that describe the rotation. So when we have here, for example, the rotation in the plane, and we have a rotation out of the plane, then we have an axis that goes here through this point. 2 degrees of freedom, and for a multi-atomic particle, we have, if it's a non-linear molecule, we have 3 degrees of freedom of translation plus 3 degrees of freedom for rotation, plus in the 2 and n atomic case, we might have sufficient energies also to have additional vibrational degrees of freedom. So in this case, for the 1 atomic gas, we have the possibility to vibrate in this direction. We cannot vibrate in this direction because this would just be equivalent to a rotation. And for a multi-atomic gas, for example, like water, we might have additional degrees of freedom describing, for example, bending modes and stretching modes. So we can now express our isentropic coefficient gamma, which was just the ratio between the heat capacity at constant pressure over the heat capacity of constant volume, in terms of our degrees of freedom. So for this, we write down Cp as the ratio between dE plus P over rho over dT. And then this can be written as Cv plus the change of P over rho over dT. Then the heat capacity as constant volume, we already saw on the previous slide, is half the degrees of freedom times Kb times the molecular mass. And in the ideal gas, we can write down this part here. So the ratio of density and of pressure and density, just as the ratio of KBT over the molecular mass. So putting this all together, we can write down Cp as degrees of freedom half Kb over the molecular mass plus Kb over molecular mass. So this can be rearranged and we write 1 plus 2 over degrees of freedom then degrees of freedom half Kb over mu. So from this we see that the polytropic coefficient gamma can be written as 1 plus 2 over the degrees of freedom. So depending on our gas, we can write down our polytropic coefficient as being 5/3 for a monoatomic gas, 7/5 for a 2-atomic gas, and 4/3 for a multiatomic gas. So from the polytropic equation of state that we already saw, that related the pressure and the density by using the polytropic coefficient and by looking at the ideal gas, where the pressure can be described as Kb over mu times density T. So the pressure is density times temperature. These two combine to the density, to the power of gamma minus 1. Is proportional to Kb over mu times T. So the energy, the energy is proportional to the density to the power of gamma minus 1. We can also look at the isothermal process, which is also very important for the interstellar medium. So isothermal here means that we have a very strong radiation field that is in equilibrium with the material. And in this case, the gamma is equal to 1. And so when the inner energy is dominated by the radiation equilibrium with its surrounding. So when we take this equation of state, we can now compute the sound speed. So we saw that the sound speed squared is dp over d rho. We now have an equation for p as a function of rho. So we have gamma p over rho. And from this, we can write down the sound speed is the square root of isentropic coefficient times the Boltzmann constant times the temperature over the molecular mass. So the sound speed is just a function of gamma, the temperature, and the molecular mass. And when we look at different cases, for example, the Earth atmosphere, where we find that the gas is dominated by the molecular nitrogen, so a two-atomic gas, which means we have a gamma of 7/5. We can look up the molecular mass, which is in the order of 4.7 times 10 to the minus 26 kilogram. We have about 293 Kelvin temperature. And from this, we find a sound speed of 350 meter per second for an N2 gas. Of course, we have a mixture of a number of molecules, so the effective sound speed is somewhat different. When we compare this with the atomic interstellar medium and assume that it's composed entirely of neutral hydrogen, so then we have a monoatomic gas for which the gamma is 5/3 with the corresponding lower molecular mass of 2.2 times 10 to the minus 27 kilogram. Hydrogen is significantly less massive than nitrogen. We have temperatures maybe of 100 Kelvin. And from this, we find that in neutral hydrogen gas in the interstellar medium, we expect sound speeds in the order of 1 kilometer per second. And when we use particle number densities, which is the common notation for interstellar medium physics, so number densities is the number of particles per volume, so the density divided by the molecular mass, we can write down the ideal gas law just as P equals N times K kb times t. So the pressure is just the product of the density, the volume density, the particle number density times the temperature times the Boltzmann constant as a constant factor. But we have to mention here that the interstellar gas is not ideal. So for example, we have collisions between gas particles. We have heat sinks and sources. We have chemical reactions and so on. So the ideal gas is not a perfect description of the interstellar medium. So with this, we can now write down the heat transfer equation that describes the energy balance for the internal energy of our fluid element. So we have the rho times the change of the internal energy with time being a combination of different components. We start by the mechanical work, so P gradient, the velocity fields, or divergence, the velocity field. That's the mechanical work. We have heat diffusion, so plus kappa times the Laplacian of the T, so the gradient of the temperature gradient, where kappa is the diffusion coefficient. When we have a temperature gradient, temperature, the laws of thermodynamic will lead to an heat exchange from the hotter to the cooler volume element, so that's the heat diffusion. We might have electric heating due to currents. This is described as J, the current density squared, over sigma, which was the conductivity. Then we have frictional heating, which is described by two terms. So we have 2 times eta Vik, which is the deformation tensor. When we write this down in Einstein notation, it is given by the 1/2 partial derivative of velocity, the eth velocity component with respect to the kth spatial component, plus partial vk over xi. And we have a second term, minus 2/3 eta minus rho times divergence of the velocity field 2. So this describes the frictional heating. And we have 2 additional terms. That take into account energy entering our fluid element in by means of radiation. So we have radiative heating plus gamma. Capital gamma is always used as heating term. And we have energy that might leave our volume element, so emission of photons. And this is then radiative cooling minus capital lambda, which is always used as cooling term. Okay, summarizing, we now have a closed system of 6 equations that describe the hydrodynamic behavior of our fluid and the internal energy changes. We have here the Navier-Stokes equation as number 1. We have the Poisson equation as number 2, describing the gravitational field. Then we have the continuity equation, which is here number 3, which accounts for mass conservation. Then we have here our simple equation of state using the is entropic coefficient. We have the caloric equation of state. And we have the change of the internal energy equation that we described on the previous slide. So in this example, so far we didn't talk about details of magnetic fields and Lorentz forces, so we ignore this term and we ignore the current heating here in the energy equation. And depending on the application, the first four equations are very frequently used to describe a problem, and the second and the fifth and the sixth equation are sometimes ignored, but this is the full system. So as a summary, we now have our system of six hydrodynamic equations, the Navier-Stokes, the Poisson and the continuity equation. We have the equation of state plus the caloric equation of state. And we have an equation that describes the heat transfer with the surrounding medium. So this includes all the gas motion, all the flows and the energy balance. And in case of a medium that consists of different species of different chemical constituents, then we have to consider these six equations individually for each species. The system is not entirely closed due to global terms, for example, electromagnetic terms, global electromagnetic radiation and magnetic and electric field terms. We have a radiation field that also couples globally many local fluid elements. And we might have interaction, for example, of gas flow with the dust flow. The dust can be considered also a fluid element, so it's their own species. Due to its much higher mass, its motion is much slower, so we will have a lot of friction, collisions, and so on. Another fundamental inaccuracy or flaw is that these six equations ignore chemical reactions which change one species into another, either by taking up energy or by releasing energy. So for example, a photon can dissociate a molecular hydrogen and produce two atoms out of one molecule. So this changes the number density of particles. This changes the isentropic coefficient. This changes the mass of the fluid component and so on. So these chemical reactions are then described by an additional set of differential equations, so a change of the number density of the particle with time as a function of some reaction rates. And of course, these chemical reactions then can heat or cool the gas in addition to what we saw already.